welcome to Church on Fire. My name is Caleb. I'm the young adults pastor here, and we are so glad that you're joining us today. Hey, we would love to connect with you here at Church on Fire. So there's two ways you can do that. The first one is text the word connect to the number 513-268-0756. We'd love to tell you your next step and how to get connected here. And the second way is to follow us on all of our social media and see what's going on. So Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. So you can follow us with the handle at My Church on Fire, and we'd love to connect with you there. Hey church, thank you so much for your giving. We couldn't do what we do here without it. And just a reminder for you, if you give online, that we are no longer using PushPay, but now we're using the Church Center app. So you can go there or mycfm.info for all the details. Hey, thanks again for joining us here at Church on Fire. Let's go ahead and continue to worship together.
We lift our voice to you. We tell you that you're worthy. We tell you that you're holy, God. Yeah. All my words fall short. I've got nothing new. How could I? I could sing these songs as I often do, but every song must end in you.
Can we sing that again? All my words fall short.
All my words fall short. I've got nothing new.
Thank you, Jesus.
And how could I express sing these songs as I often do, but every song must end, and you never do. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again, 'cause all that I have is a I've got one response, and I've got just one move. Thank you, Lord, with my arms stretched wide. Oh, I will worship you.
Together we say,
and come on my soul, oh don't you get shy on me, lift up your song, 'cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise, we praise you, Lord, we praise you, Lord. Oh, come on my soul,
yeah, sing it out, declare it this morning,
'cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs.
No matter what we feel, no matter what we think, God, we know you're good, Jesus. So come on, come on, my soul.
Don't you get shy.
out this morning. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on and lift your hallelujah in this place. God be praised. You are worthy, Lord.
Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We bless your name. You guys hear me? All right. Thanks.
Amen. There it is. I thought I sounded unusually quiet, which isn't something people normally say. So, morning, church. Such an honor and privilege to be with you. I almost missed the cue to come up here because, man, worship. Woo! He is powerful. He does miracles. God, we believe in you. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. 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 Well, we've been doing something for the last few months now. We call it the declaration. We're going to do it right now, but I don't even know why I feel led to say this, but sometimes I don't want to declare what I believe because I don't want to offend people. In the Church on Fire, on the side of the building, it says, we love people, and I want people to know how much we love them, more importantly, how much God loves them. And so when we say things like this, and there's a few lines in there that even me as a pastor on staff, I'm going like, I hope people know we love them when we say this. But I want people to know more than anything that the Bible is real, that Jesus is real, that God is true and good, and we will not depart from this word. So when we're saying things, these things, we're not just saying them to be declarations. We're not just saying them to be divisive. We're not just saying them to plant our foot in the ground and say, we're not moving. We are reminding the world that it was built on a foundation. Jesus, the Word of God, built the very foundations of this earth, and we are aligning ourselves with truth itself when we say these things. So we're going to say these things together. You can just repeat after me. But that's why we're doing it, because we love people and we really love God and God loves them. So let's say these things together. We believe in God the Father and in Jesus Christ, His only Son. We believe in the Holy Spirit. We believe that Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection brings us life and the forgiveness of sins. We believe in the biblical outlines of marriage and gender. We believe in the sanctity of all life, regardless of race or nationality, beginning at the moment of conception and ending at death. We will do anything short of sin to see people come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, because we love people. Amen, amen, amen. You guys can go ahead, high five a few people as you take a seat. Amen. Good morning. Amen. Wesley, will this mic, is it just me? Should I take it off or leave it on? Is it going to mess anything up? Okay. Alrighty. There's very few things that the devil really hones in on to attack. But if your life's anything like mine, technology's one of them. I feel like it never is doing the thing it's supposed to do, which for me is a sure sign of a demonic attack. So, just being silly. Alright, so we have so many incredible things happening all the time. We are blessed to be able to be a part of the community, be a part of what God's doing locally and globally. There are people all over the world who are supported by the generosity and the obedience of your tithes and offerings. And we're doing ministry right now. The lights are on. Your kids are being ministered to. Everything that's happening is because we're obedient to God in our tithes and offerings. So thank you, thank you, thank you for being obedient to God, and thank you for your giving. Just a reminder, maybe you've been coming for a while, or maybe you're new. We've changed our giving platform to just make it really, really simple. It's Give Online at the Church Center app. We have our very own app. We're that cool. And so we make it simple. There's a tab there at the bottom that just says give, and you can tithe there. And if you're having any issues with that, you can call the office during the week, because we know some people have run into some things. So just let us know. We're more than happy to help you with that so that you can be obedient to God in your tithes and offerings. So thank you for being a giving, generous church. We're thankful, and we are careful with how we steward this, and we're just grateful to God to be able to partner with the work that He's doing. So thank you, church. And just a reminder, join a group. We're actually launching a new semester of small groups today, right now, and to use the app again. Like we said, it's simple, it's easy. Everything is central there. You can go to the app, find a group there, go to the Harrison. There's men's, women's, young adults. There's all kinds of options for you to be plugged in to people who are like-minded, who you can link arms with and learn about God, follow Him, and serve Him together. So join a group. It will literally, at times, save your life. So you said, well, I don't believe you. Join a group and find out, okay? And if it doesn't save your life, join another group, because the next one will. So, for those of you guys who have been around for a while, my name's Pastor Matt. I am the pastor formerly known as the high school pastor. So I was the high school pastor. Now I've moved on to being in charge of small groups and over discipleship and a few other things, but I will never stop being a high school pastor in my heart, which means that I will never stop talking about the cool stuff our youth group is doing all the time. So we have Fire Conference coming up in a month. Yes. The parents are yelling, students are clapping, multiple reasons. Parents are yelling because their kid is gone for 36 hours. Students are yelling because they have encountered God at Fire Conference before. So please, no matter what is going on, I talked with one of the students that I really love about an event that they have going on, and I was like, just don't show up. Don't go. Come to Fire Conference instead. And I understand, we're joking about the importance of these things, but the truth of the matter is they will change the trajectory of our lives anytime we give God a chunk of time for him to work on our hearts and surrender to him. And the same is true in our youth. So March 10th and 11th, and again, you can sign up at mycfm.info, or you can use the app at mycfm.info, and you can just click sign up for Fire Conference. And if you're too old to go to the conference, we still need people to help us run the conference, and you're able to sit in the back away from the cool kids, and we'll thank you for serving and being a part of what God is doing. We need your help to make this happen. We are so grateful to steward this move of God that he's doing in our young people. It is incredible to know that every week there's over 100 junior high and high school students who are taking time away from their busy schedules to meet God every week in this place. And there's going to be hundreds of them come March 10th and 11th here in this church. So please, if you have a student, if you are a student, if you know a student, get them signed up for Fire Conference, okay? Yeah. Amen. So you guys may have noticed there's a little bit of a different thing going on with the screens today. Again, we're just having technological difficulties, the windstorms, all these different things are happening. So if at any point in time I accidentally reference the side screens and nothing shows up, as every good breakup goes, it's me, not them, okay? So it's me, it's my fault, they're doing great back there, so we're just going to do our best with the screens and it's going to be incredible. Last week, Pastor Doug spoke brilliantly on, he started our series on intentional gifts about the Holy Spirit. He talked about how the Holy Spirit empowers us and he equips us, and his kind of title of the message was the gifts are meant to be, it's good to re-gift. Re-gifting is a good thing. And so he also reassured us that the Holy Spirit is not weird, and that's important that we understand, because if we think the Holy Spirit's weird, either consciously or in some deep recess of our mind, we might detach ourselves from this interaction with a third of the person of God. And we can't do that and live a full life with Jesus, with God, and with the Holy Spirit. We can't live a fruitful life doing those things regularly. So it's important we understand the gifts are for today. The Holy Spirit's not weird. These gifts are meant to be re-gifted. And Pastor Doug was emphatically showing us that the gifts are for now and that we're meant to share them with others. So there's a few major scriptures about gifts. He mentioned most of them last week. The two kind of bigger ones are 1 Corinthians 12 and Romans 12. And so 1 Corinthians 12 is this really powerful chunk of scripture. It has the spiritual gifts. There's prophecy. There's gift of tongues, the interpretation of tongues, the super spiritual. It talks about healing. It talks about miracles and faith. It talks about knowing things you shouldn't know because God told you. And it takes somebody deeply wise and very super spiritual to be able to preach on that. So I'm not. Pastor Doug's going to be talking about that for the next 2 weeks. But today, I'm talking about Romans 12. So we're going to be in Romans 12, verses 4 through 8. We're going to get there in a second. But before we do, let's pray. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you. God, I thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus. You are the King. You are the Lord. You are real. This is not some game. We aren't just up here in a rhythm of church on Sundays. We are asking for a fresh move from a real spirit, from your real throne in heaven, God. We love you and we thank you that you're coming into this room today to change us and mark us, that the seeds that are sown would take deep root in our hearts and bear fruit in our lives, that we would have eyes to see, ears to hear, and hearts to receive what it is that you want to do. And let us be doers of this word and not just hearers only. Let it be a lamp into our feet and a light into our path. God, we love you and we bless you. In Jesus' name, everybody said amen. Amen. So a picture is going to go up on the side screen? Yes. So this picture is very famous location. If you know it, yell it out. Taj Mahal. Nailed it. Okay, so it's the Taj Mahal in a place called Agra in the country of India. The Taj Mahal became famous in the 1960s. In the 1600s, it was built by an emperor, and it's now a UNESCO World Heritage Site. It made the list of the new seven wonders of the world. It's built on 42 acres of beautiful gardens and architecture and fountains flowing around, and it's massive, and it's important. Because it was, and you guys actually, can you leave it up on the side screen for now? Thank you so much. I want us to look at it because it is a picture of what a king did for his wife. It's not a palace. It's not a vacation home. It's her tomb. It's a mausoleum. Many of you may have known that. But it's wild to me. Because if you adjust the money he spent to today's dollar amount, he spent over $1 billion in almost three decades building this monument as a gift to his dead wife. All the planning, all the effort, all the money as a gift to his dead wife. And you're like, why do you keep harping on that? Well, Church on Fire, the Christian Bible, it talks about this God who is the king of the universe. This God who's the king of the universe that loved us so much that he sent his son to earth so that his son could live a perfect life, die an unjust death, be crucified, and then raised to life again so that we could be forgiven and we could have eternal life with God. And not only did he do that, but he actually left the earth to go be with the Father again, Jesus did. And they didn't just leave us to our own devices, they sent the Spirit, who is the power and presence of God, to move among us on this earth. And now the Spirit's job is to equip the people of God to be used by him to build the bride of Christ, to build the church. So a dead king spent almost 30 years and over $1 billion building a monument to his dead bride. And some of us, maybe we're a little reluctant to let the Holy Spirit use us, or we come from backgrounds where the gifts of the Spirit are not alive and well today. But if a dead king did all of that for his dead bride, you had better believe that a real live king of the universe is going to equip us and empower us and gift us to build his living bride for his son today. That is happening. So, thank you for the picture of the Taj Mahal. Let it be a warning. We're not working for anything dead. We're building something that brings life. Romans 12, 4 through 8. Paul is writing and he says, just as our bodies have many parts and each part has a special function, so it is with Christ's body. We are many parts of one body and we all belong to each other. In his grace, God has given us different gifts for doing certain things well. So if God has given you the ability to prophesy, speak out with as much faith as God has given you. If your gift is serving others, serve them well. If you are a teacher, teach well. If your gift is to encourage others, be encouraging. If it is your giving, give generously. If God has given you leadership ability, take responsibility seriously. And if you have a gift for showing kindness to others, do it gladly. That's the gifts. And the crazy part is Paul is not writing a comprehensive list. He's not listing them in their totality, in their entirety. He is giving us examples. He's making a point to us. Remember verses 4 and 5. Just as our bodies have many parts and each part has a special function, so it is with Christ's body. We are many parts of one body and we all belong to each other. We are the body of Christ, the bride of Christ, and we are meant to work together using the gifts the Holy Spirit equips us with. So Valentine's Day is coming up in 2 days. Some of you men are finding out about it for the first time right now. You're welcome, okay? Valentine's Day is in 2 days. Some of you guys have worked out this deal with your spouse where neither of you, you're like, it's a Hallmark holiday. We don't celebrate that. Please teach me how, okay? How did you do that? But no, it's irrelevant because every year around this time, I walk into Kroger and I see people stop in their tracks and like, oh no, what are these for? Oh no, it's coming. And then if anything, October, there's a holiday in October called Sweetest Day, which catches me off guard every year. I didn't even know it happened until a week later last year. But I walk into these places and I go, what are the gifts for? What are the flowers out for? What am I missing? And so in our faith, if you grew up in a background where you didn't talk about the Holy Spirit, it just wasn't a part of the conversation of Christianity, or maybe you grew up in a background where it was so weird and chaotic and so misused, and the Holy Spirit was so misrepresented that you've just decided to avoid him totally, that's not okay either. And now we're talking about the gifts and the Holy Spirit, and we have to go, well, what are they for? When we see this, we have to acknowledge something is different, and I have to prepare myself, okay? What are the gifts for? Why does the Holy Spirit equip us with gifts? We have to know before we step out here, because we can't just be people, the Bible talks about just craziness and chaos and all these things when people start to get into the Holy Spirit, and that's not what it's for. What is it for? Let's look at 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 10 and 11. It says, God has given each of you a gift from his great variety of spiritual gifts. That means there's a lot of them. There's many of them. Use them well to serve one another. Do you have the gift of speaking? Then speak as though God himself were speaking through you. Do you have the gift of helping others? Do it with all the strength and energy that God supplies. Then everything you do will bring glory to God through Jesus Christ. All glory and power to him forever and ever. Amen. Hebrews 2:4 is another scripture, and it says, and God confirmed the message. What is the message? It is the good news. It's the gospel of Jesus. It's the fact that Jesus came to this earth, died on a cross for our sins, lived his perfect life, and became the sacrifice that we should have been. Then he rose from the dead and is now in heaven. That's the message. That's the good news. And God confirmed the gospel of Jesus, the message, by giving signs and wonders and various miracles and the gifts of the Holy Spirit whenever he chose. So why does the Holy Spirit equip us with gifts? The Holy Spirit gives us gifts to bring glory to God and to share and confirm the gospel. That's why he brings us gifts. That's why he gives us gifts, to bring glory to God and to share and confirm the gospel. And we build up one another when we use them, and we share and confirm the gospel in each other's lives. We remind ourselves, Jesus is still on the throne, your life's going to work out, and then we bring glory to God and we tell people about him, and this thing keeps perpetuating. It keeps going, and the Holy Spirit keeps using us, and the kingdom keeps growing. He gives us gifts to bring glory to God and to share and confirm the gospel. We had a night of worship a few weeks ago, and it was incredible. If you were able to make it, you know. If you weren't able to make it, come to the next one and find out. It was a move of the Lord, and I know people were touched. I was touched myself. And if you were there, you might have seen that I got a chance to come up on stage, and I got a chance to share a message of Jesus and ask people if they wanted to accept them into their hearts that night at the night of worship. And I was just praying earlier in the day, kind of as is usual for me, just asking the Lord, do you want to say anything? God, please, I submit myself to you. I submit that time to you. And I felt like the Lord said, there's somebody who's going to be coming there who's giving me one more shot. They're giving me one more chance for them to meet me. And I just kind of, I was like, I don't know, I'm not sure. Maybe that was me, maybe that was the Lord. And so I talked to Samantha. She was like, well, if you said it, say it. And so I got up on stage and I said it. I said, you know, if somebody's here tonight, if you want to, you give Jesus the last chance, please, you know, he wants to let you know, he hears you, he sees you, yada, yada, yada. And I, not yada, 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 it was the Lord speaking. Excuse me. Sorry, Lord. So, I'm just discrediting myself is what I think I'm trying to, in my mind. It's going, I just didn't feel good about it. I did not feel confident about it. And when I got off stage, I was like, even in my mind, completely honest, I was going like, I think I missed it. I don't know if the Lord even said that. Lord, you know, forgive me if I spoke out of turn. Forgive me if I didn't do what it says. And then 2 weeks ago on a Sunday before Pastor Bruce spoke, somebody came up to me. They're in this room right now, and it blessed me that they even got, you know, came up to me. So thank you for saying something. They came up to me and said, hey, I think that was me. And they shared some breakthrough that happened and some things that had gone on, and we became friends, and they told me this story. Like, I think that was me that you were talking to that night, or God was talking to me through you. And it encouraged me to know, like, God actually used me. And you're going like, wow, you're a pastor. Yes, I have that self-talk. We all have that self-talk. It's going on in our heads all the time, to the gifts of the Spirit and asking God. God used me. He gave me a gift of the Spirit when he spoke to me earlier in that afternoon to say the thing. And then he used another gift of the Spirit when I got up on this stage and spoke that out with confidence and just believing it. So it's important to remember, as we talk about the gifts of the Spirit, there are things that are going to help us. There are things that are going to encourage us. They're going to bring glory to God and share and confirm the gospel. The gospel was shared and confirmed that night through a gift of the Spirit, and God was glorified. Yes. That's the gifts of the Spirit at work. And it's not because I'm awesome. I felt very unawesome. And that's actually point number one. The gifts of the Holy Spirit are about our faith, not our feelings. Yeah. The gifts of the Holy Spirit are about our faith, not our feelings. There's some movements and things that have gone on in church history where it was very emotional. It was very tangible. It was very visceral in the way we felt things. And it was motivated by the way we felt and how we feel about these moves of God. And I just want to acknowledge that God makes us feel good because he's a good Father who loves us. But we cannot let that reflect the way the Holy Spirit is moving in our life. Our faith and our feelings are not synonymous. Look at the book of James. James 2, 14 through 18, it says, "What good is it, dear brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith, but don't show it by your actions? Can that kind of faith save anyone? Suppose you see a brother or sister who has no food or clothing, and you say goodbye and have a good day, stay warm and eat well, but then you don't give that person any food or clothing. What good does that do? So you see, faith by itself isn't enough. Unless it produces some good deeds, it is dead and useless. Now, someone may argue some people have faith, others have good deeds. I say, how can you show me your faith if you don't have good deeds? I will show you my faith by my good deeds." Amen. The Message translation, it puts it this way. "Dear friends, do you think you'll get anywhere in this if you learn all the right words but never do anything? Does merely talking about faith indicate that a person really has it? For instance, if you come upon an old friend dressed in rags and half starved and say, 'Good morning, friend, be clothed in Christ, be filled with the Holy Spirit,' and walk off without providing so much as a coat or a cup of soup, where does that get you? Isn't it obvious that God talk without God actions is an outrageous nonsense?" But people, we in church, we're part of this Western culture, this American culture. We get it messed up. It's now even just a part of our life to talk about vibes and the way we feel. And I know it doesn't make me feel good, or that person gives me a weird feeling. And we're just very aware of ourself, very conscious of our feelings and our emotions. And that has produced a lot of fruit in people's lives. We're getting healing emotionally and mentally, and therapy's good, and all of these things. Acknowledgement is good. But what it's allowing us is an easy eject button whenever we're uncomfortable. And we have to walk this line between our feelings and our faith. And when we have to make a choice between the two, where does our heart go? Where do we lean? Where do we let the Spirit use us? In our feelings or in our faith? I think some of us have mistakenly made faith and feelings synonymous. And if we don't feel the Lord's presence, or I don't have goosebumps, or I'm not shaking, there's not this fire in my gut, well, then the Lord's not using me. Or I must not be ready to be used by God, or I don't feel filled up with the Holy Spirit. And maybe it's a little more serious than that. Maybe we're letting our feelings drive our faith in God. And when we feel like following Jesus, we do. But when we don't, we stop saying yes to him. And we choose the old things. And then when we have a good day, we have a good day. But when it's a bad day, we just let the bad day take us down the old paths. And that's not what faith is for. That's not how the Holy Spirit wants to work in our lives. We might know that people are, there's work to be done. We might know that people are actually dying and going to hell. And that's not an angry preacher. That's just the Bible. We might know a whole lot, but we aren't just feeling the Holy Spirit. We aren't just, in connection with the river of the Lord flowing down like a fire in my gut. Well, that's not how it's going to be all the time. Faith is not like that. Faith is going after it whether it feels good or not. It is getting involved in the nitty-gritty work of saving the world and letting God use us to do it. How does he use us to do it? Through gifts of the Holy Spirit. There's this book that tells the story of an African pastor and his opinion on Western Christianity. And this author is kind of recounting this interaction that he has with this African pastor. I'll read the interaction this way. "The African pastor expressed the Western Christian's faith in the image of a hunter raising his rifle to shoot at a stag from a great distance. The Western faith, the pastor said, likes to imagine that the goal and the work of reaching the goal can be kept a great distance away from the hunter. But the African way of thinking about faith, which is of course the biblical way of thinking about faith, presents us with a much more visceral image of a lion pouncing upon a stag. The lion's whole being is required in the action. Its sinews and muscles and bones are all vitally central to the task. But of course, the hunter from a distance only needs to aim and move his index finger a half an inch. We can see why that may somehow be preferable to the lion's approach, but with regard to faith and belief, it is not at all adequate. We need to engage with everything in us. The lion needs everything. It needs to give its all to overcome the obstacles and accomplish its work. And when we are talking about the Holy Spirit and the gifts of the Holy Spirit and our faith, we have to remember that the Holy Spirit is not a theological concept to wrestle with in some far-off way. He's not some eerie spirit that we just ponder and make inferences about. The bona fide truth is that we can engage with a living God who wants to empower us with gifts, and he wants to reach other people to bring glory to him and share and confirm the gospel. Gifts of the Holy Spirit are about our faith, not our feelings. And if we want to engage with God and be a part of this great adventure, we might have to start rejecting some of our feelings and grab hold fiercely to our faith in God. So number two, the gifts of the Holy Spirit are for everyday use, not a church service. And I'm sorry in advance. I know. I hope you hear this one. Please hear this, because remember why the Holy Spirit came, right? To share and confirm the gospel and bring glory to God. The gifts of the Holy Spirit are not meant to be something we just see and use and engage with for an hour and a half once a week. And I might be going rogue, I might ruffle some feathers, Pastor Doug can settle them next week. But the idea is, and I mean this gently, and I'm just going to offer you this idea. The gifts of the Holy Spirit should primarily be used outside of the church building. Amen. If we're going to clap, let's clap. Yes. Well, why are we clapping? Well, the Bible says so. 1 Peter 4, 10 and 11. We'll read them again. God has given each of you a gift from his great variety of spiritual gifts. You might be sitting in your seat thinking, well, I can't get up on stage with a microphone, or I can't get a prophecy, or I don't have the gift of tongues, or whatever it is you are discrediting yourself for. He's saying there's a variety of spiritual gifts. You might be kind. That's a gift. You might have generosity. That's a gift. You might be someone who's crafty and you can, make things for people. That's a gift. There's somebody in this room right now who gives cards to people on staff at this church. And every month, it is a joy for me to receive their gift through the Holy Spirit. And it's not some public thing that we always have to get, stand in the spotlights that make us sweat. We just have to understand that God has gifts and he's given them to us. And we can use them outside of the church. So do it with the 11. I got off topic. Do it with all of the strength and energy that God supplies. So for those of you who are worried that you're busy or that you're tired, yes, all of us are. Whether or not we're in full-time ministry or we're in full-time vocational work, whatever you want to call it, however you want to quantify yourself, there's work to be done. And God is going to give us energy to do it if we say yes to him. So do it with all the strength and energy that God supplies. You don't have to stir it up in yourself. God is going to give you the strength and energy. Then everything you do at church, it says, no, it doesn't say at church. Oh, in your Bible, it doesn't say in your small group. It says everything you do will bring glory to God through Jesus Christ. All glory and power to him forever and ever. In Hebrews 2:4, God confirmed the message by giving signs and wonders and various miracles and gifts of the Holy Spirit whenever he chose. Whenever, wherever, God's going to do whatever it takes to reach people, and we can partner with him. Yeah. Oh, how awesome is this? Like I mentioned, Valentine's Day is coming up, because there's a parallel we can draw. While not romantic in a traditional sense, our relationship with God, there's an intimacy there and a closeness there. And so my wife and I, we go on dates, and we don't go as often as we like, or, we have two toddlers, we got a busy schedule, but when we go on dates, we enjoy each other's company. And what we don't do on dates is stir up all of the love that we have. We don't starve ourselves in between the dates. And then when we're on the dates, we start talking about how great the other one is. And we look deeply into each other's eyes. And we say all the sweet nothings, that two people who are so madly in love like I am say. That's not how it works on a date, right? I'm just going to give you a little tip. If you're single or maybe you need some help, the romance is built between the dates. Yeah. Our dates are a reflection of what has happened since the last date. If our marriage has been stale and lackluster, if our love has grown cold, you better believe our dates will be cold and lackluster and stale. And some of us walk into church and we wonder, Why is this service stale and lackluster? Why is it cold in here? And you see somebody on the front row or somebody in the back row who's encountering God and wondering, well, why is it? The romance is built between the dates. Yeah, if you can clap again. The gifts of the Holy Spirit are for everyday use, not just a church service. This faith with God, we're missing out on a massive percent if we just show up at church on Sunday and expect God to move and only use us then and only use us there. And he's going, I've got so much work for you to do. I've got so many things for you to accomplish, so many adventures for you to go on if you would just say yes to me outside of a building. We have got to engage with God. Pastor Josh was actually telling me about a conversation he had with some other guys, and they were talking about this faith and how to live it out outside of these walls, and one of his friends asked this question, and it blew me away. He said, how short, how empty, how small would the Gospels be if Jesus only did miracles in the synagogue? Where if only the only things Jesus said were in the synagogue. The only time he did a miracle were in the synagogue, which was their church building at the time Jesus walked around the earth. How short and how skim, how much of a shadow would they be if Jesus only did miracles in there? But then we show up to church and we put God in this church box. We put God in this, you know, church on fire building shaped box. And we go, well, I'm only going to get used by him. He's only going to encounter me there. I'm only going to let him, and we just emaciate our faith. But the gifts are for everyday use. Our faith is more than our feelings. We can get caught up in something incredible if we say yes to God. And all of us in here, I know small groups are starting. You're going to go, oh no, he's going to talk about small groups. We've talked at length about how being a part of a small group is part of taking that faith outside of this building and injecting it into our everyday life. It's hard to find time in your schedule. It's difficult to make friends with new people that you don't know. Some of us are in our 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, and you've got friendships that are older than me, and you're going, I don't need new friends, or I don't want new friends. But God is going, there's a great work to be done, and I need you to partner with like-minded men and women who you can link arms with and start conquering principalities and powers and doing damage to the kingdom of darkness and building up the kingdom of light. And small groups, you might say, wow, that was a lot to say about small groups. Well, there's a lot to do. And small groups are a great way to get into interacting with it. If you're confused or you don't know what to do, another way to do it is do growth track. Some of us in here, I did not know my gifts in the Lord from a video game when I got saved. I was so confused. When you said gifts of the Spirit, I literally thought of presents, like Christmas presents. I had no gauge for anything of God. And so some of us in here, we might be there, and you say, well, what's growth track for? Growth track is for finding out how you can get involved at Church on Fire and helping equip you with an understanding of your gifts and how God can use you here so that he can use you more out there. Small groups and growth track, and yes, I am in charge of both of those things. So just to sum up where we've come so far, the Holy Spirit gives us gifts to bring glory to God and to share and confirm the gospel. The gifts of the Holy Spirit are about our faith, not our feelings, and the gifts of the Holy Spirit should primarily be used in your everyday life, not just in church. So that brings us to our third and final point. I'll wrap up, and then you can go start making your dips and your sauces for the Super Bowl, okay? And I was about to say something that would have caused controversy. Thank you, Lord, for taming my tongue. Hallelujah. So Matthew 25, verses 14 and 15. Jesus is telling a parable, and he says, again, the kingdom of heaven can be illustrated by the story of a man going on a long trip. He called together his servants and entrusted his money to them while he was gone. He gave 5 bags of silver to one, 2 bags of silver to another, and 1 bag of silver to the last, dividing it in proportion to their abilities. Then he left on his trip. So this is a parable. Jesus, again, is telling it, and it's a parable about stewardship. It's not exclusively about the gifts of the Spirit. It's not exclusively, some of you may have heard it told, about money or about whatever. It's just about anything that God gives you to steward and how you take care of it. So it's a parable, and to paraphrase it, what happens is the servant who was given 5 bags by what some translations call him the merchant, the master. So the servant that was given 5 bags makes 5 more bags. The servant that was given 2 bags makes 2 more bags. But the servant that was given 1 bag, he's so scared and fearful, and he has such a skewed view of this master that he serves that he, in fear of losing the money, just goes and hides it away until the master returns. And when the master returns, he calls the servants to him. And they present themselves. And the one who made five shows the master the five that he made. And it pleases the master greatly. And the one who made two, was given two, shows the master that he made two more. And this pleases the master greatly. But the servant that hid his one that he was given, this is the interaction that he has. This brings us, right up to our third point. I'll say the third point, and then I'll read how the master reacts to that last servant. The third point. When it comes to the gifts of the Holy Spirit, you either use them or you lose them. And I know I want to give a really encouraging, happy word that really warms your heart, but we just have to be attentive to what the scripture says and what God is doing. And so we'll read it in Matthew 25, verse 26 to 29. But the master replied, "You wicked and lazy servant. If you knew I harvested crops I didn't plant and gathered crops I didn't cultivate, why didn't you deposit my money in the bank? At least I could have gotten some interest on it." Then the master ordered, "Take the money from this servant and give it to the one with the 10 bags of silver. To those who use well what they are given, even more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who do nothing, even what little they have will be taken away." If you don't use them, you lose them. And this is not the threat. This is not a threat of an angry and merciless God. These are not the cavalier consequences of some far-off, totalitarian, egotistical father who's commanding his children. These are gentle warnings from a father who loves us, from a savior who gave everything for us, and from a Holy Spirit who wants to empower us and use us and take us on some grand adventure. But if we aren't using those gifts, if we aren't doing those things, our world is lost and broken and dying. And they don't know the love of Jesus. They don't know God. It's apparent everywhere you look, every show you watch almost, except for The Chosen. And just a public service announcement. If you haven't seen The Chosen, watch The Chosen. I've been burned before as well by Christian media. The Chosen's different. There you go. There you go. And instead of watching the Super Bowl, watch The Chosen. I said it. I'm just kidding. You can watch both. All right. Our world is lost and broken and dying. And I make a joke because it is so deeply heavy to me to know there are souls every day who go into eternity without knowing Jesus. And he warns us, if you don't use what I give you, I'm taking it away. And what does he do with it? He gives it to the ones who are using it. Why? Because our God loves his children too much to sit back and let his other children waste their gifts while people are dying and going to hell. He just loves people too much. He will do anything short of sin to see people know him. He will take what he has to take. He will do what he has to do because he cares so deeply. And if we sit idly by and let our faith be dictated by our feelings, or we just imagine God to fit in this Church on Fire size box, or we're not using our gifts, he loves us too much to let it go on like this. I was thinking a lot about the post office this week. I don't know why, but I was, and I was reminded how the post office actually got started. For those of you guys who don't know, it was actually in post office was the way that it worked for its entirety up until a certain point. Was that if you thought you had mail, you would go to the post office, go to the window, and ask, "Hey, does Matt Clark have any letters?" They would look in the back, find your letters, or find nothing, and come and tell you, "Here's your letters," or "You don't have any mail." And that's how the post office worked until 1862, when a man named Joseph Briggs got involved with the Cleveland, Ohio branch of the post office. So in 1862 and 1863, you might not have lined up the timelines, but that was the Civil War, the bloodiest war in our nation's history. And Joseph Briggs is a post clerk. He's just an assistant to an assistant at the Cleveland post office, but he sees these people lining up in the freezing Cleveland winters to get news. And so he's sitting there at the window, and people he's watching wives, mothers, sisters, even sons and daughters line up to get the news, find some shred of hope of that their loved ones are surviving, that they're any good news they can. They're lining up in the freezing cold, and he's trying to think of what to do. He sees them cold. He sees them shivering. He sees their brokenness and their hopelessness, and he's wondering what to do, but he's just a mail clerk. And so he goes, you know, I can't start fires. That's illegal in the city streets. The post office lobby is way too small to have anybody come here. So what does he do? He does something more radical than starting fires in the streets or inviting everybody inside. He decides he's going to personally deliver the letters to the people. And that's how we have our home delivery system that we have today. Joseph Briggs thought it up in Cleveland. He was not some well-connected, wealthy merchant who, you know, could use a vast amount of resources. He wasn't some incredible leader who was able to delegate and all these things. He was just a mail clerk who saw hurting, broken, hopeless people and decided he was going to take the news to them. We have to do the same. People are lost and broken and dying, waiting for the news of Jesus Christ. And God is going, I will equip you. I will gift you. I will empower you. I will do everything you need if you just say yes. There's over 1 billion letters delivered every year to homes in America because one man saw a problem and decided he was going to be a part of fixing it. And I know there's billions of souls that will be saved if just a few of us would grab hold of Jesus, the cross of Christ, ask the Holy Spirit into our life so that we can be the love of God in their lives. He wants to use us. And the Holy Spirit, he wants to gift us and equip us and empower us. And this is not just some rote, rhythmic thing that we do. Like, we are involved in a fight, a life or death fight. But our God's already won. He's already won. And he's won for you. If you're sitting in this room and you're going, I'm the person in the cold. I'm out. I need the news. I need Jesus. I need hope. I need a Savior. He wants you today. He wants you right now. You may have done things you're ashamed of just as recently as last night. You might have been in a lifestyle of sin. You might just be sitting there thinking, well, you don't know who I am. You don't know what I've done. And you're right, but he does, and he still came to the cross for you. The Bible says while we were still sinners, Jesus died for us. That means he knew what we were going to do, and he still went to the cross. If you're sitting in this room, he wants you. He wants to be your Savior. The Holy Spirit wants to be your helper. God wants to be your Father. You're going to have an opportunity to make that decision right now. Can we bow our heads? If you're sitting in this room and you're going, that's me. I want to get caught up in this adventure. I want to be used by the Holy Spirit. I want to partner with God in seeing people saved. I want to use the gifts, however small or grand we think they are. I want to say yes to Jesus right now. Would you raise your hand right now? Amen. 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 All over this room. You can put your hands down. Amen. Amen. Can we all stand to our feet together? We are going to pray in just a second. We're going to take a moment and ask the Lord into our hearts. And if you raise your hand, we would love to see you back at the Jesus wall back there. Somebody's ready to help take your information. We've got a path lined up for you. You may know how to read the Bible. You may have never even opened a Bible, but there is a path that God is going to take you on, and we want to help you along it. So please head back to the Jesus wall, and somebody's there waiting for you to talk with you if you raise your hand. But for everyone in this room, I wonder if we would pray this morning, if we would just quiet everything going on in our life for a few moments, what God would ask us to do, how he would ask us to use our gifts. So that's what we're going to do. The band's going to play a song. They're going to sing. But while they sing, I'm going to ask the Lord for a moment to speak to us. What is one thing he wants to use your gifts to do this week? One thing. Maybe it's a person. Maybe you bring donuts to the office. Maybe you pay for the groceries of somebody behind you or the coffee of somebody behind you. Maybe you give a compliment to somebody that you have not, you know, they've gone unnoticed for years. Whatever it is, however he's going to use your gift. And it's going to look different from person to person. But if we all do a little, Pastor Doug says, it becomes a lot. So let's ask the Lord right now. Let's bow our heads. Lord, we know you want to speak to us. We believe you're not some far off, distant, silent God who's left us alone. You are moving. You're even in this room right now. God, we thank you. Holy Spirit, we ask that you would speak to us right now. What is one way you want us to use our gifts? What is one way you want us to use our gifts? Please speak to us now in this moment. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. It doesn't have to take long. I've heard somebody say that short prayers are easy when you live close to the throne. So Jesus is in the room right now. He doesn't have to dial long distance to get to our hearts when we submit ourselves to him. So he's speaking to us, and maybe you felt like you had a block. Maybe you felt like you couldn't hear something there. He wants to speak, and it might just be in an instant this week. You might have a thought that normally you would not have. That's the Holy Spirit nudging you. A thought that is positive, a thought that is encouraging, a thought to do something, and you're going, well, maybe that's not God. If you wouldn't normally do it and it would improve somebody's life, it's probably God. So let's step out in faith. Let's not wait for our feelings to catch up. Let's expect him to move outside of these walls and inside of these walls. And let's trust that if we keep using these gifts, he's going to keep trusting us with more. And if we don't use them, then we're going to wonder why our life is shallow and broken. There's always time for redemption and to turn around. So like those people raise their hands, we say prayers in this church often. It's as simple as A, B, C, D. We admit we need Jesus. B is we believe in him. We tell him, I believe the Bible, believe Jesus is who he says he is. C is I confess my sin. Confess. The Bible says if you confess your sins to God, he's faithful and just to forgive you. Forgive us our sins. And then D is do it. Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commands. Like James said, we're not just going to be faith people who don't do anything. Simple as A, B, C, D. So we're going to say this prayer together. And while we do, can the altar workers come down, please? So speak it out with me. Say, Jesus, I admit I need you. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus, I believe in you. I believe you came to this earth. You lived a perfect life. You died on the cross. You rose again. And you did it for me. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus, I've sinned. I confess my sin. I'm sorry for my sin. Please forgive me. I'll say this. I am forgiven. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. I'll say, Holy Spirit, come into my heart. Fill my life. Equip me and empower me with your gifts. Let's end this way. Say, I am a child of God. I am born again. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hey, thanks again for joining us at Church Online. And we really appreciate you joining. We appreciate you commenting. Just appreciate you so much for being a part of what we're doing here. And we hope this touches your heart. And so today, maybe you gave your life to Jesus Christ. Maybe you said, I want to receive Christ as my Savior. I want to live for him. I want you to do me a favor. I want you to text the word heart to the number listed below, 513-268-0756, so that we can get you on a path of following and serving the Lord. So just want to say to you, thanks again. And I want to end with a blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you, be gracious unto you, and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hey, we'll see you next week at Church Online.